Good afternoon and welcome. We're glad to be joined by so many American Academy members for a special opportunity to hear from two of our newest members, Katie Kariko and Drew Weissman. We're proud to have them among our membership, and we're excited to hear about their incredible work on mRNA vaccine technology. Today is an opportunity for all of us, who represent the breadth of disciplines and perspectives that characterize the Academy, to ask questions, build connections, and celebrate two of our colleagues. We're grateful to Katie and Drew for taking the time and look forward to a program that emphasizes audience participation. I want to thank Temple University's Nora Newcombe and the University of Pennsylvania's Kathleen Hall Jamieson for bringing us together this afternoon. Nora and Kathleen chair our Philadelphia Program Committee. Today is the first of what they have imagined to be a series of events where Academy communities across the country shine a spotlight on a local colleague, introducing them and their work to the wider membership. The COVID-19 pandemic reinforced just how important it is to maintain connection and introduce new ways for those connections to transcend geographic barriers. I want to encourage you to consider who we could highlight in your community and to be in touch with suggestions. Now let me turn things over to Nora and Kathleen, who will introduce our speakers and moderate today's discussion.
So yeah, welcome. Thank you, David, and thank you to Drew and Katie for being with us. So this idea even goes a little beyond what David talked about in that we're trying to leverage something that we had just gotten going in Philadelphia before the pandemic, ironically enough, in terms of today's topic, which was trying to greet new members and trying to really establish a feeling of camaraderie and that there was a local group to which you could belong, and we would do things like, you know, just us, and, you know, because if you're not in Boston, you don't have that. The Boston people have that. So that was a real ongoing effort. And in the fall of 2019, we had a delightful dinner in which we welcomed some new members, and then you know all what happened. So meanwhile, Drew and Katie are not just illustrious members, they actually are new members. So this is part of, as we all try to kind of get going again, trying to jumpstart the feeling that we are a community and that we're trying to actually welcome new members. But we thought we'd do it nationally because it would be interesting. So Kathleen, do you want to say a few words?
The Philadelphia chapter is so proud that these two distinguished individuals are part of our chapter and part of our community. We're proud as well that, and Nora indicated that some of our activities got closed down by the pandemic. They've helped to quell the pandemic. They also have saved the lives of millions. And in the process, they have demonstrated not only the importance of basic research, but the importance of translating theory into practice. So they've made all of us at Penn particularly proud for any role that their time at Penn played in their many accomplishments. And with that, I'd like to introduce Katie and Drew in any order that they would like to tell us anything that they would like to tell us about their contributions and about where this important new understanding of how biology works and how we can protect the public might be affecting us in the future. Katie, why don't you start?
Thank you. This is a great honor to be here. Good afternoon, everybody. I am a biochemist by training, and I work with RNA actually under my when I did my PhDs in Hungary and later when I moved to the University of Pennsylvania. And I was interested in mRNA, but not until I met Drew Weissman realized that this mRNA is actually inflammatory. And why I want to develop for therapeutic purposes, treating a patient who has heart attack or stroke, with Drew, when we did the experiment and he used these very special cells, I didn't even know about, then learn, you know, that the RNA I am making is inflammatory. So that on with Drew, we try to understand why it is inflammatory. And as we did all of these experiments, we did not realize that we can make the mRNA non-inflammatory. That was so critical to use for today's many of the application, not just for vaccine, but for other things. But the importance is, you know, to work together is because I learned all of the immunology from Drew, and I I hope that I try to tell you as much as I could about the RNA. And so we were two different fields talking to each other and find a common ground and then develop further. And so we this non-inflammatory mRNA, which you know, we could make it and which ensured that not just no inflammation occurred, but also that more protein was produced, RNA was more stable, and of course, you know, companies were formed at it. We also formed with Drew, but you don't know about our company. But we did further developed and tried to, you know, Drew will talk about that he was always interested in vaccine. And I tried to develop for therapeutic purposes. And that is when I went to Germany. And for the last 10 years, actually, I worked for the BioNTech, where, again, my role was to develop for therapeutic purposes. And that's what I did for mRNA coding for antibody and other proteins, which are very expensive as a protein product. But the importance of the RNA is that not inflammatory, but other things is that it is cheap, very quickly can be made. And if you think or talk about today, the future actually is already happening. So this messenger RNA can be used not just for vaccine and many different vaccine, Drew might talk about it, but also for therapeutic purposes. And right now, many in the clinical trial and many people were not aware that even as this messenger RNA, this nucleoside modified RNA was already in the clinic well before the pandemic happened. And infectious disease vaccines, RNA, messenger RNA was used for infectious disease vaccine even 2014 in clinical trial, 2015 for influenza, rabies, and Zika virus, already in human trial. But the people thought that it just happened all of a sudden it was used in humans. So it was not how it happened. And so we work shoulder to shoulder, really, with Drew, because we didn't have much financial support, and we did our experiment, and we were always excited, and it was so much fun. And so maybe Drew can say more about that.
Thank you. So I need to thank the Academy for electing us. I'll first point out, this is an example where teamwork of people working together accomplished this. I would guess, and I can never be sure, that alone, neither of us would have come up with this modified RNA. But by working together, you know, literally next to each other for 15 years, sharing our information, which was very different. Katie was in the neurosurgery department. I'm an immunologist. But that sharing, the interaction, the talking is what I think helped us develop this new technology. So as people know, I'd like to talk about the future. And people see the COVID-19 vaccine as a great product, as a great new vaccine. I'm much more excited about what's next. There's over 100 clinical trials using RNA therapeutics going on right now. There are many vaccines in clinical trials for Zika, for influenza, for herpes simplex, for HIV, and for many others. We and others are working on vaccines for non-infectious diseases, things like food allergies, peanut allergies, for autoimmune diseases. RNA is being used in many different therapeutics. There's already been a clinical trial using RNA for gene therapy that had phenomenal results. All of the high-dose patients were cured over a year out from treatment now. We've made CAR T cells in vivo, avoiding that $500,000 cost. So the potential for RNA in the future is enormous. The growth of companies, of academics involving RNA researchers has been phenomenal. In the old days, Katie and I would go to a meeting And there'd be, you know, maybe 100 people there. And they were the hardcore RNA scientists. Now, RNA meetings fill up the room and overflow into other rooms. Thousands of people come to these meetings. So Katie and I both think RNA is the future, and we do everything we can to support that. Thank you.
So we now want to hear from people with their questions. We would like you to put the question in the chat, but then either Kathleen or I will sort of call on you and you'll be able to unmute and ask your question. So nothing's in the chat right now. I'm going to take the opportunity to ask the first question while you all get to typing, which I really appreciate the forward look, and I'd love to talk more about the forward look, but I do have a kind of backward look question, maybe because I opened by talking about the fall of 2019. How soon, as we began to go through the winter of 2020 and learn more about the novel coronavirus, did you two think this is, you know, our moment, we could do something? When did it dawn on you?
I worked at BioNTech at that point, and we already started to work with Pfizer at BioNTech in 2018 to develop messenger RNA-based influenza vaccine. And those well advanced was really ready for human trial. And it demonstrates how quickly you can change make an other RNA, which codes for a different viral protein. And you know, also everybody was aware that in January, in the beginning of January, we learned the sequence information. And in March already, March 16 was the first volunteer was already injected. So very quickly you can generate a new product. And you know, in our case, the CEO of our company made the decision that we will pursue that, so that we, and he reasoned that Wuhan was a big city, and then it airport and so on. But what was critical is that there were people who were infected and they were had no symptoms, and he said that they would spread that virus, because in other cases, you know, when the virus is so deadly that and make everybody sick, they are not traveling.
So I think it was probably October of 2019. I'm in an infectious disease division. We have a lot of epidemiologists who study disease transmission. And I had a close friend at the Wuhan Virologic Institute, where all of this was surrounding. And I was talking to him in October, and the story that he gave me about the disease was different from what was being released from China. He was telling me that many people were getting a cold, a sore throat, high fever, and a lot of people were dying. And they were very concerned about this. And that instantly got my attention. And we started at that point knowing that the RNA vaccine would be the best approach, because as Katie said, it's fast, it's quick, it's inexpensive, it's easily scalable.
So Mark Schlissel was, I think, first in typing something in the chat.
My kudos to the work. It's obviously going to be taught to generations of students moving forward, how basic science investigation over the course of long periods of time can have profound impact on clinical medicine. But I guess to Drew more particularly, he intimated there are clinical trials going on for non-immunological treatment, non-vaccinations for other diseases where there are long-term gene therapy-like effects from introduced RNA. Yeah, my question is, how do you imagine the mechanism of such an effect given the relatively shorter half-life of even heavily modified RNA molecules in vivo?
Actually, with Drew, we wrote a preview about that. Maybe the gene therapy promise was fulfilling by the mRNA therapy, because you can start to.
Yeah, no, it's a great question. There's two approaches you can think about. One is you replace the missing protein with an RNA LNP delivery. The better, I think, is you deliver a gene that edits and corrects the DNA. So you're actually doing gene therapy in vivo. And why that's critical is we have a number of gene therapies, some that are FDA approved. The cost of those gene therapies is in the $1 to $3 million range. And when you've got a disease that affects 1,000 people in the world, that's not unreasonable. But if you wanted to develop a gene therapy for, say, sickle cell anemia, where 300,000 people a year are born with the disease, you can't treat 300,000 people with gene therapy at a cost of $2 million a piece. So what RNA gives you is the ability to do the gene therapy in vivo. A simple injection of RNA LNPs is all you need. The LNPs target the cells of interest. The RNA encodes a protein that edits the genome and fixes or deletes the broken gene.
At many times, you know, we also get this question, but, you know, at the beginning, why we would do an RNA, you know, is not a long lasting effect. But, you know, most of the disease, what we have is not a genetic disease. We have aches and pains and wounds. And that's actually one of the clinical trials when Moderna and AstraZeneca started using a VEGF-A mRNA. VEGF-A helps new blood vessel formation, and they put to the diabetic patient's necrotic wound to increase the healing. And so many of the disease doesn't require that kind of molecule would be there forever.
Very good, thank you.
Let me move to a social science question. Factcheck.org and SciCheck run through the Ann Arbor Public Policy Center, which I direct. And we were faced with a deception about the vaccine that was predicated on a general lack of technical knowledge, I think, on the part of people that said this vaccine is going to alter people's DNA. If you are talking to a person who is not schooled in the technical aspects of the science and honestly believed it might be a problem, that the vaccine might alter DNA, how would you explain to them that they need not be concerned about that? Because I'm looking for the kind of language that we could quote back to say, from the scientist who created, here's how we know, you don't need to worry about that.
So I talk to lay audiences all the time, mostly addressing vaccine hesitancy. And that's one of the more common things that comes up. What people have to understand is the RNA that's in the vaccine is identical to the RNA that's already in our cells. It codes for the spike protein instead of a cellular protein, but everything else about it is identical. All of the structures are the same. RNA, messenger RNA, doesn't go into the nucleus and cannot edit our genome. Our cell is full of mRNAs, and we're just adding another one to it. So that there is no chance that that RNA can change our genome.
Katie, is there anything you would add?
And even it's a viral RNA, you know, like the coronavirus is not incorporating ever in our DNA. That to go back from the cytoplasma to the nuclei and then have something special elements on that messenger RNA to be able to make DNA from the RNA is not present in these RNA. And we don't have any protein because for the retroviruses, which can go, you know, the RNA can go inside the nuclei, they have special protein to carry. RNA has special elements. We don't have any of these, so it won't happen. So it's not enough to get the RNA. The RNA had to be reconverted to DNA and double-stranded DNA and inserted somewhere, and you don't have the tools there. There is nothing there, even if somebody has HIV.
Thank you. And now we have a comment and a compliment from Thoreau Pedersen. Please open your mic.
Compliment with an E and I, the selection of pseudouridine and methyl pseudouridine of the hundreds of modifications of RNA that occur naturally. There was great wisdom in choosing these two. I won't go into the details with how the modified structure of pseudouridine is more stable to its complementary base A in the mRNA, stabilizing its structure. Point about speaking to lay audiences, I encountered a person who didn't want either of the mRNA vaccines because the RNA had been doped. That was an opportunity to write a piece in PNAS, an encounter with a layperson in the RNA, what I said, that the doping is not some horrible chemical dependent group that's been attached, but is a naturally occurring modification. And I've spent a lot of time talking to lay people, and I know Drew has as well. I think you have Germany. This is enormously important, and the media has not done us a good thing. If I could just finish my comment, spending a whole year ignoring immunity in vaccinology of COVID, that finally, anyway, bravo to you both.
Any response, Drew or Katie?
I have to say that if you search pseudouridine on Google, the second or the first place coming pseudouridine is toxic. So, because that's what the people search for, that the pseudouridine is toxic, and you know they don't know that pseudouridine is the fifth most abundant nucleoside in our body. And we have in our mRNA, at that time when we did with Drew, we didn't know messenger RNA also has it, but it has in our mRNA and many of the other RNA, ribosomal RNA and small RNA. So it is present, so it's not toxic.
Yeah, I could spend hours talking about all of the oddball things people accuse RNA and the vaccine causing. We're currently working with the Annenberg Center to address hesitancy and misinformation, trying to figure out ways of combating the spread of misinformation to help reduce hesitancy.
That's wonderful, because the messaging is so different than, you know, science. The next person is Mitzi Kuroda.
Hi, so I was hoping one of you could comment on the prospects of personalized cancer vaccines and how soon those might be coming online.
I mean, BioNTech started to make personalized cancer vaccines. It meant that the patient sample is shipped to mines and sequence it and identifying those proteins which had mutation resulting amino acid chain. And then we generated these so-called neoepitope specific messenger RNA coding for this one. And then it was shipped back to the patient. And this was like, it was like 6 weeks later, they could get their own vaccines, which is specific for their tumors. And it seemed that, you know, if somebody has a large tumor, the immune system is not have enough energy there to, or enough cells to kill that tumor. But what is in the news was there, both from Moderna and from BioNTech, that if somebody has a melanoma or colon cancer and the cancer is removed and there is no metastasis, if the patient, and then using that tumor to identify which are the mutation and generating these specific vaccine for the patient, then the patient is treated week after week. And then what was the result is that the tumor did not reoccur, because that's the very frequent for colon cancer, melanoma, that, you know, the tumor is coming back. So right now, this is where the success lies. But, you know, with other technology, with T cells, with other not vaccine related technologies, you know, we get better and better, and hopefully even large tumors can be eliminated.
We're definitely making steps in the right direction. Both Moderna and BioNTech have personalized cancer vaccines that have shown efficacy in certain circumstances when they're combined with checkpoint inhibitors. So I think now, you know, we're on the right track, and we need to probably add a few more therapies in order to get better success.
And seeing the result will be constantly learning from the outcome, and then the next person get the better and better vaccine.
Well, thank you. This is just so amazing.
And the next question carries through the same theme. Jean Taylor, please open your mic.
I was wondering if there is any chance of this working for autoimmune diseases. And Dr. Weissman, being an immunologist, that was the first thing that leapt to my mind. My disease is controlled by squashing my immune system, which keeps me alive, so it's terrific, but it's extremely limiting. I can't go to concerts. I can't take public transit. I'm just totally vulnerable. So any chance? I look for hope anywhere I can find it.
So there are many animal studies right now that are using vaccines to turn off autoimmune diseases in an antigen-specific manner. Ugur Sahin of BioNTech was the first to show in a mouse model of multiple sclerosis that he could turn off the pathologic immune response. And that's now being extended to a variety of autoimmune diseases, as well as environmental and food allergies. So this is a very active arm of research. I don't know if any clinical trials have started yet. I don't think so, but my guess is in the near future, we'll see them.
To find clinical trials, you asked your own doctor?
That's the best place to start.
So in this case, which I participated on this multiple sclerosis model animal treatment model for multiple sclerosis, you know, that we could treat the animals because we induced their autoimmunity, and we knew that what we use, what kind of peptides we use to induce it. So the problem which we have to solve and to understand that for different individuals, when they have autoimmune disease, what is the target of their autoimmunity? Then he repeated the application of the molecule without adding some kind of danger signal to it, repeatedly providing that kind of protein, you could tell the immune system, please tolerate that, there is no danger. I learned from Drew how immune system works. So you can repeatedly present something without a danger signal, and then your system will tolerate. But we have to identify that what is, let's say, your immune cells is responding to.
Yeah. So all of the animal models are based on autoimmune diseases where the antigen is known. The hope is that in the future, there's something called epitope spreading. And what that means is that maybe if you target 3 of the 5 antigens, you'll get spillover that will turn off the others. So I don't tell people it's hopeless for diseases like systemic lupus, where there are many different antigens, but it's going to take studying to understand.
Yeah, it sounds like there is hope.
Yep.
I think the next person is John Heuser. Apologies if I mispronounced that.
No, thank you. You pronounced it correctly. My question is, first of all, I want to thank you so much for sharing your wisdom with us today, both of you. It's marvelous. I'm very interested. Drew has said repeatedly mRNA LNPs, LNPs, the lipid nanoparticles that are the delivery vehicle. And to me, they are a very important thing cell biologically to understand as deeply as possible. I'm concerned about whether they can be improved to target specific cell types in the body with, for specific diseases. And I'm concerned whether the current ones that are used might be causing side effects or be some of the problems. And I've asked Peter Cullis in Vancouver, who developed a lot of them, this question, and he just laughs like it is a big problem. And I'd appreciate your opinion.
No, you're exactly right. And my lab has developed the technology to target the LNPs specifically to other cell types. So that there's really two things that you bring up. The first is that the current LNPs used in the vaccines have adjuvant activity. And what that means is that they activate the immune system, which makes the vaccines work better. So people that want to use the LNPs for gene therapy or for therapeutic protein delivery are developing LNPs without adjuvant activity that don't induce inflammation. For targeting, we've been able to target LNPs to a variety of organs and tissues. We go to lung, to heart, to brain, to kidneys, to T cells, to CD4 cells, and our latest are bone marrow stem cells. And what's exciting about that, there's about 7,000 genetic diseases that have been identified, and a few thousand of them are in the bone marrow. So that includes all the immune deficiencies and many red cell, sickle cell, thalassemias, other diseases that have very poor treatments. The problem with gene therapy is you have to make gene therapy specific for every mutation. And for many thalassemias, there's hundreds of mutations. So that's hundreds of different gene therapies at $100 million a clinical trial and $2 million per treatment. We've been able to target bone marrow stem cells with 100% efficiency. We can gene edit all of the repopulating stem cells. And we're now using this to treat sickle cell anemia, where a simple injection is all that will be needed. So that can be given to Africa, India, and the rest of the world, where people with sickle cell reside.
That's absolutely wonderful. Is there a place we can read about that?
So we've got a paper submitted. It'll hopefully be accepted soon that describes the bone marrow stem cell targeting.
Thank you very much.
And of course, for the therapeutic purposes, we are using different kind of lipid formulation, like for the tolerization, which we mentioned against, treating autoimmune diseases, we leave out that ionizable lipid components, which is the immune activator, because you want to repeatedly deliver some kind of mRNA, which is non-immunogenic, and the lipid should not be immunogenic. For lipid in BioNTech, we use for cancer also the conventional RNA, which is activating by itself the immune system. And in that case, when we change the composition of the lipid, just the ratio, how negative or positive that the particle is, can go to the spleen or can go to the lung or the liver, so it you can change the ratio of composition and you can target by that way also.
Before going to a question from Larry Corey, let me ask a follow-up about lipid nanoparticles. As we follow the emergence of conspiracy theories, and conspiracy theories predict a vaccination hesitance, we saw the conspiracy theory that said that the vaccine contained, by the admission of the creators, lipid nanoparticles, and the nanoparticles were in the vaccine in order to do any number of malign things, among them to track us. So when you heard first that your vaccine had lipid nanoparticles that were being used to track us, what was your response to hearing the conspiracy theory? And then how would you respond to people who are people of goodwill who are genuinely concerned because they've heard from someone they trust, and a misplaced trust, but believe now that there's something there that might hurt you.
So at first I laughed when people accused Bill Gates of tracking, putting chips in the LNPs, because they would sit there and type it in on their phone that follows you everywhere you go and logs everything you do. So why would Bill put a chip in something when you've got his cell phone in your pocket? The LNPs contain four lipids. Two of them are naturally occurring. They're in our body all the time. One of them is a pegylated lipid that's about 1% of the total. So you get a tiny little amount of that. So there's one lipid in the LNP in the vaccines that is considered foreign to our bodies, the ionizable cationic lipid. And that's also the lipid that makes the vaccine work by having adjuvant activity. The lipid is cleared from the body. It's digested and removed from the body within a day or two. We haven't seen really any significant effects from that lipid. We've seen no evidence of toxicity, no evidence of adverse events from the lipids themselves. There are adverse events that are associated with the vaccine. There's the anaphylactoid reaction that occurs in all vaccines, but happens a bit more often with the RNA. And then there's the myocarditis that's seen in young men that's easily treated, mild, and goes away in a couple of days. This vaccine has been tested more than any other vaccine in history. And it's probably one of the safest that's ever been developed.
And let me just add, when Drew says adverse events and is using a language the CDC uses, the public hears adverse events to be something really serious. But the CDC's definition includes things that happen after vaccination, whether they are serious or not. And I wish that the health community would recharacterize and get rid of the word adverse events, because a layperson is misunderstanding that when it is used in its technical sense. Katie, any other response on lipid nanoparticles?
Now, this adverse effect, I might say something about interesting that the people mentioned that so many people get the adverse event after getting the mRNA vaccine, but they didn't list that how many people who get the saline, you know, the placebo arm. They also complain about headache. They were excited and get many, many other events, and they recorded that. And if you look at now, recently, looking at this, what people get after vaccination, happens something to them, and they think that it probably the vaccination. And these include pregnancy. More than a dozen person complain that they get pregnant from the vaccination because they happen to be pregnant after the vaccine they found. Also that for syphilis, you know, that 20 something people complain that they get syphilis, you know, from the vaccine, because it happens after they get the vaccine. But, you know, prior events, they don't think about that. So that many cases, you know, when they talk about events. But you have to also understand for the vaccine, if I may say, is that none of the medical intervention is inert. And, you know, the vaccine was not received by healthy people, you know, people had other diseases ongoing. And as we mentioned that, you know, the ionizable lipid is to stimulate the immune system. If something is ongoing in somebody's body, that, you know, it can accelerate. And so many people realize that, for example, the wart disappears from their hands, because most likely their immune system was fighting it and get a little boost. But of course, if they have some kind of joint inflammation, they might get worse. But so there are some events there really related to the vaccine.
And what was your response to hearing that you had put lipid nanoparticles in order to track people?
Yes. I mean, I respond the same way like Drew is, that first, like, it is so laughable, but then I can see that people are so serious. So that's why, you know, today again, you know, every day we are helping the people to get educated, because if they would be educated, they wouldn't believe things like that. They rather ask questions and not loaded questions, you know, when they said, you know, we are what we have done already, but they were really genuinely interested to learn. And yeah, I just sent over Drew another one, you know, that we are packaging RNAs to the RNA. And they, you know, I mean, that will be the last thing we would want, because it would degrade the RNA and then there will be no effect. But yes.
So part of what you're telling us is that the social scientists need to keep working to try to make sure that the public understands what it is that the vaccines do and do not do, and to figure out how the public hears the way in which we talk about all of these things.
Yes, yes. So I respond to every high school project. They are asking me, I help them, because, you know, helping educate them, and then maybe their parents eventually, you know, they will be more educated, and then they will not listen to some weird ideas.
Yeah, some people call that a trickle-up effect. Thank you for doing that. We now have a question from Larry Corey.
My question is a little bit about the science part of things. Sorry, my video doesn't seem to be going on. But it relates sort of to the durability of the vaccines. Maybe at first a little bit of a surprising finding, and that while boosting replenishes the antibody response, there's still a pretty profound decay. And, you know, particle-based protein vaccines seem to not have as much of a decay. So I don't think it's sort of a basic immunological issue, that there is something there. So you're pretty aware of that. So I guess I'm looking at, do you have a sort of a mechanistic issue behind that? Is there a way to improve this as from a durability point of view?
I think part of the problem is the definition of durability for the COVID vaccine isn't really correct, because new variants, as you know, keep appearing, and every new variant has lower or much lower sensitivity to the original neutralizing antibodies. So having to get boosted every 6 months because Omicron or XBB.1.5 or another variant appears that's much less sensitive isn't really measuring durability. There are studies that look at antibody levels and neutralization of the original Wuhan isolate, and those titers drop. In our studies of mice and macaques and some people, the titers drop a little slower than many protein vaccines. If you look at people who have received live virus vaccines, they have long-lived immunity, but they don't have super high antibody levels. So durability in them is likely due to memory B cells and T cells that respond quickly and clear the infection. For COVID, we're measuring circulating antibody levels, and they drop, they have to drop. That's what they do after vaccines and what they do after infections. So I think we have to be careful how we how we define durability.
Okay, but the drop in to Wuhan is still quite considerable. Yeah. But okay, I hear you. All right, we won't debate too much here.
The next person is a person who asked a question before, but no new person has gotten in the chat. So John, you get a second question.
Thank you for the second opportunity. When Drew mentioned that they're targeting bone marrow cells, when we know how sort of isolated they are in our body, this gets me back still to mechanism. When a vaccine with these lipid nanoparticles is put into our arm, subcutaneous tissue or shallow muscle, could you explain to us Where does it go? What cell is it delivered to? What cell is the cell that actually makes the spike proteins for us? So these are all still mysteries to the public and to a lot of us in the scientific community.
It's a great question. I've been pushing my postdoc to write this paper. We've done PK studies, distribution studies, and what we find is that after you give the vaccine in the muscle or in the skin, within 4 hours, you find lipid nanoparticle and RNA expression in just about every lymph node in the body. They quickly leave the muscle and distribute to lymph nodes, to spleen, to liver, and the RNA is expressed. If you look at what cells are expressing the RNA, it's really every cell or just about every cell that contacts them. But in particular, the dendritic cells have the highest level of expression. When we do, when we stain tissue and look for who's expressing the protein, the dendritic cells are incredibly bright and the surrounding cells are very dim. So dendritic cells are the principal cell that takes up the lipid nanoparticles, and they're the main cell for its vaccine effect. If you give the vaccine intravenously, you see the liver taking up a lot of the LNPs from a first pass effect. But if you look, the dendritic cells are also lighting up and by taking up the LNPs and translating the RNA.
If I might add, Drew is talking about the mice. You inject and you can see almost every lymph node. It's not in the human. In human, just you find a nearby. So, you know, and the mice is a small, and actually for the toxicology, other things, you have to always inject, although even the rat is used for that, the same highest dose you want to intend for a human. And of course, the rat is so much smaller than a human being. And of course, it can spread much more. And eventually we had 150 microgram injected to the rat and the human being at just 30 microgram and just in local and much smaller. And what we found is that is the macrophages, because macrophage and dendritic cells are the primary cells, even in the muscle, because you think that your muscle is just muscle. It is full of macrophages. And they are the cells whose role is to picking up things, and they can pick it up and migrate to the nearby lymph node, and also the, as Drew mentioned, the particle can get there also. But when we try to overexpress for the therapeutic purposes, you know, not for vaccine, I am not a vaccine expert. I work at BioNTech also for therapeutic purposes, and we try to make the muscle to make protein, and we deliver different ways. It was very difficult. We finally changed all of the secretion signal and other things to which was muscle specific, and still we had struggling the muscle to make proteins, to pick up the particle.
And the next question comes from our president, David.
I have a question on the medical side about breakthrough cases. Of course, people who've been vaccinated but still come down with the COVID disease. Is there evidence that vaccinations still benefit those individuals? In other words, in terms of the probability, say, of getting more serious case or getting long COVID, is there benefit even from people who then get COVID after the vaccination?
Definitely. And you, there's still a large number of cases of COVID in the United States and across the world, but there's much fewer people dying. It's still high. It's still about 1,000 a day compared to tens of thousands in the past. What we know from the vaccine is that the T cell, the cell-mediated immune response, helps protect against severe disease and death. And that can occur with either prior infections or with the vaccines. So the vaccines are critical. They may not prevent a new infection with a different variant, but they're going to protect the patients, the people, from developing more severe disease.
And actually, the new variant is as deadly as the older variant or the original one for those people who are not vaccinated. So when the people say, oh, this is not as serious now because less people are dying, because more people get vaccinated. I would also say that only 10% of the long COVID cases related to those who already were vaccinated. Most of the long COVID patients were like 90% who have never been vaccinated. And in those cases, they found that vaccinating them who get long COVID, one third get improvement after they vaccinated them. But in these days also, they are treating with Paxlovid and others also can have some help. But long COVID is a serious issue. 5 million people in the world has long COVID.
Okay, and there's a question from, and I do not speak Spanish at all, Luis Andre Barroso.
I would have guessed you'd know how to speak Spanish.
I'm lucky.
Just hearing the conversation, I was curious from our two speakers or others in the audience, so much was talking about here about miscommunications or misrepresentations to the general public. And I may be mistaken, but I'm under the understanding that at least in the UK, there exists such a thing as a faculty position or on the public understanding of science and technology. I don't know, don't believe that there is such a tradition in the US. I could be mistaken, but I was wondering for those of you who've been involved in this journey of vaccination, whether you feel like such a thing would have been useful. I don't know actually how effective those folks are, perhaps in the UK, but I feel like a theory that I have is that this could be useful in the US.
I think it would be very useful. I think anything that would help inform people correctly is needed. To me, the biggest problem in the United States and across the world is in the old days. So I've been making vaccines for 30 plus years. In the old days, there were always a few anti-vaxxers. And you excuse my characterization, but they were typically California hippies who turned down all treatments and all medicine. And as a vaccinologist, you learned how to deal with those people. But now with social media, the reach of the anti-vaxxers and the misinformation is so broad. And that misinformation is also being carried by our politicians and our religious leaders. And those are people that the population, that people in general listen to. So that there's so many different reasons and causes of the misinformation that I don't think one type of event or one type of change is going to fix that. But we really need to sit down and figure out how do we address each of these situations leading to misinformation and vaccine hesitancy.
We do have an area in the United States Academy, and as well as globally, that focuses on science of science communication. And scholars from across disciplines are identifying in that way. And some of the concerns that you raise are being addressed globally as well as in the United States by those scholars. Much of their work was encompassed inside the public face of science report that the American Academy put forward, and the National Academy of Sciences did a series of colloquia to advance science of science communication. I'm going to ask a quick question and then turn to a final question from Kathy and then from David. We now have an RSV vaccine that is on the horizon, and it's going to be delivered by giving a pregnant woman a vaccine with the expectation that their infant will be protected for the first 6 months. And that raises the reality that there are concerns about vaccinating pregnant individuals that are not concerns about vaccinating people who are non-pregnant. We have in our Annenberg Science and Public Health Knowledge Survey evidence that there are people who vaccinated themselves and were comfortable about it. They support vaccinating children. They were comfortable with it. And this is with the mRNA vaccine. But they are hesitant about whether or not it's advisable to have a pregnant woman be vaccinated. How do we know that it is safe for a woman or person who is pregnant to be vaccinated with any of the vaccines against COVID, but in particular the mRNA vaccines?
I mean, those studies were principally done in Israel. And the reason Israel did it was that they were seeing high rates of adverse events, if I can use that word, of bad outcomes to pregnant women who were getting infected. And that they instituted vaccination of pregnant women because they felt that blocking the infection was the most important thing that would save children's, infants, and women's lives. Looking back at that now, there are not serious effects of the vaccine seen during pregnancy. And it's commonly used across the world that pregnant women are getting the RNA LNP vaccines.
When vaccination was drawn in the beginning, you know, that those who volunteered and signed, they signed that they will not get pregnant. But, you know, it happened. And they followed already during those 41,000 people, you know, who were volunteering, for example, for the vaccination for the Pfizer-BioNTech vaccine. And they followed them, you know, what happened. You know, they signed that they won't get pregnant, but they get pregnant. And, you know, they looked at the child and followed the mothers.
And what do we know about the protection that vaccinating for the person who's pregnant, the protection that is carried to the infant who is delivered?
Oh, they can measure the antibody level in the milk, for example. People send me, you know, the measuring the antibody level in the milk. And their milk, so that also get there through the milk as well as through the womb. Yeah.
We've done a lot of studies on vaccinating pregnant mice. We're now moving to pregnant non-human primates. And what we see is very good antibody transfer. It's typically around 80% of the adult level, the mom's level, you find in the infant, and it mediates protection. The duration of protection varies. In humans, it's usually thought in the neighborhood of around 6 months from maternal antibodies. But it's, of course, variable and dependent on the level. But it's well described that mother's antibodies are in the infant and protect the infant during the early period of their life.
And now another general question, this comes from Kathy A. How often should we get vaccinated now?
It's a great question. I don't have an answer.
I usually ask Drew also that question. Should I get?
Well, Kathleen, my I don't mean to interrupt, but my question actually would have been a perfect question.
Go ahead.
The most important question. My question is not more, you know, there's a lot of half-lives involved here. Drew has characterized the distribution following intramuscular injection. Muscle is highly vascularized. We all know that cells, that's very interesting. I didn't know about that. There's the variation to which the spike protein is translated with the machinery in various cells. It's probably how well it's secreted through the ER into the bloodstream, probably fairly constant. Lifetime in the bloodstream, probably fairly constant, but the half-lives of the immunes that are triggered, B or T, is not necessarily the same in every individual. So I just would say that there's a lot of half-lives we have to be thinking about. And I think that's the precursor to cancer. So, Kathy, where are you? We need you, and we need the answer.
That's exactly right. And it's even beyond that, the amount of antibody and the amount of T cells that a person makes is spread over a wide range. Yeah. So it in the infections, 5% of people may very poor antibody responses. The people who are sicker may much better response. There's a wide range, and we can't tell along with, you know, how often we need to vaccinate them. So I think it's really going to be the CDC with Moderna, Pfizer, and BioNTech who determines how often we need to get boosters.
But Tora, I might mention, it is not secreted. The spike protein is has transmembrane domain. It is on the surface. So it is not secreted.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you for reminding me of my vision pathway. Katie, thank you very much. Thank you.
And we now have a final question from our president, David Oxtoby.
Well, first of all, before I give the question, let me thank you for a wonderful presentation. We learned so much from this last hour. And let me say that I hope that both of you as new members will be able to join us at the end of September for our induction. It's a very special moment, and I don't know if it will fit your schedules, but we really hope to see you in Cambridge for induction at the end of September. So just one broad question, which you might take in different directions. You've talked about collaboration, the collaboration that the two of you have established over a number of years. One of the Academy's strengths is our breadth of expertise, and I'm curious about collaborations beyond in surprising areas with other disciplines. We've heard a little bit from Kathleen about collaborations between scientists and social scientists in terms of communication. But I'm interested in your thoughts about broader collaboration.
I mean, that's a great thing to work with communicators because, you know, on my own, I try to help the high school students, the reporters, and try to, that's the only reason, or that's the thing I found that what is the getting all of this award that, you know, get to the spotlight and talk about the science, so the spread the news and better understanding. But, you know, I was just like an amateur on this field, a professional probably, you know, can direct better that how to do it, definitely.
I mean, we continue to expand our collaborations. Mm-hmm. We have enormous collaboration with scientists, but what we're really trying to expand is with other professionals, other lay people. We work with engineers. Mm-hmm. We work with people, you know, with veterinarians. We work with business people. We especially work with communications people. I think that's probably the most important thing that we need to do for this pandemic and the next one and the next RNA drug that comes out. Mm-hmm. So, you know, collaboration, as I mentioned in the beginning, is the only way to get things to work. If mm-hmm. Katie and I didn't collaborate, I don't think we would have an RNA vaccine right now. Katie and I strongly support all sorts of collaboration.
Thank you.
Nora?
I want to thank you. Thank you for your work. Thank you for being here. Thank you for answering our questions. Enjoy all your travels. It sounds like you're going lots of places.
Thank you.